On Sunday mornings, I like to share ideas that can be used to improve the quality of our lives. We draw upon many different resources: psychology, philosophy, religion, parapsychology, metapsychology, just about everything that can be used to improve our lives on a day-to-day type of basis. Because religion, unless it's meaningful, unless it has an application, is just an intellectual exercise, as it were. One person's opinions against another person's opinions. But if it is used on a day-to-day basis, if we are living our belief, whatever our belief is, then it is something that is affecting us on a day-to-day basis. And that's really where life should be, where we are part of an ongoing process of universal life. Universal life being the mind and the spirit of Almighty God. Now, on Sunday mornings, I like to take and go more into the transcendent and the mystical aspects of spirituality. There's many different aspects of metaphysics, but when you get to the very highest form of metaphysics, it all blends into the very source of all of our knowledge, which is the mystical. And the word mystical doesn't mean the psychic. The psychic is a very small part of it. Mystical simply means the pursuit of God's presence, or ultimate presence, or ultimate identity within ourselves. Now, to get started this morning, I'd like to start with a healing treatment, and I'm going to ask if you would you put both feet flat on the floor, your ankles crossed, or whichever is most comfortable to you. And let's turn inward for a few moments to work upon the health of our bodies. I turn away from the outer world that surrounds me, that I may enter into the innermost world of my mind. For within my mind is the consciousness of universal life, that which created my body, that which gave me consciousness on a mortal level of reality. And so I turn back in to that state of consciousness within myself. I flow back into that mind which is as a field of light within me, a field of light that has been seen by people down through the ages and has been equated in the consciousness of people as the presence of God. So that light that is within me is the source of life, the creative intelligence which created all of the functionings of my body. Let me feel that my body, now filled with millions and millions of cells, each as a little energy factor within itself, is being influenced by that light, that the light is radiating into the nucleus of every cell of my body, from the crown of my head down the length of my body to the soles of my feet. Here within me, the consciousness of light, of universal life, is in the process of maintaining my health or restoring it wherever restoration is necessary. And so that light now is in me, surrounding me in an aura of light, at work in the involuntary organs of my body, adjusting, renewing, regenerating. And if there be any localized area of my body that is in need of healing, right here and right now, that light is centered there, focused there, and I am in a divine state of conscious cooperation with the ultimate mind spirit that is God within me and throughout me. And in this state, I am in a state now of harmony. Harmony and balance with all of the forces of nature, all of the activities of nature, with the skies, the forests, the trees, the oceans,
the sun. My body is in harmony with nature. All is in balance. All is well. And I accept this as a reality throughout my body, in every area of my body that is in need. The light has met that need. The light of my spirit and my mind is right there, right now. And balance, polarity, exists throughout my being. For my inner mind, containing God's light, is everywhere active, maintaining health, restoring health throughout my body, throughout all levels of my mind, removing blemishes from my soul, leaving it free and pure. Holy and divine. For this realization, this day and every day, I give thanks. I let it be so throughout my body. And so it is.
Our subject for today is turning failure into success. It's an important subject because many times as we go through human life, we feel that possibly we have failed. And you know, we get that started in a tempo when we're small children, especially those of us that are raised in the Western culture with the Christian Judaic type of concept from the Bible, which suggests that we are born sinners. Now, that's a pretty negative self-image to start off with, because as you go to Sunday school as a child, you have this feeling, you hear, well, man is born a sinner. The word sin has a really bad connotation if you start to think about it. Sin is almost equal to, hey, this person is evil. Wow, this person is really a culprit. This person is no good at all. Because to be a sinner is, that's pretty bad. At least as we think of the word sin. What it really meant was that the person was born with a karma. That's the real meaning of the person was born in sin, the person was born with karma. That's the metaphysical, mystical aspect of that. So what do we equate sin with then in a metaphysical and a mystical way? We equate it with error due to lack of consciousness of our oneness with universal life. In other words, we error, we make mistakes, we stumble and fall because we don't know any better. We lack an awareness of universal life and our position and our reality with universal life. And so, every time we stumble, according to whatever culture or society we're living in, we can be called a sinner. We did something wrong, we did something bad, we were a bad boy or a bad girl, and hence now we're a sinner. Now, as you grow up with that hanging over you, unless you know the right interpretation of it, by the time we reach our adulthood, and we've had some experiences in our teenage years and our adolescent years where we've failed at doing something and been criticized oftentimes by not only our peers, but older people as well, we have a pretty negative image to start off with. So let's suppose then you go and get a job and you fail at the job. You get fired for whatever reason, justly or unjustly. There you begin to think of yourself then as a failure. Or perhaps if you're very industrious, have a streak of entrepreneurship inside of you, you go into some type of business. You become self-employed. And you start this business, and after a while it fails. And here comes this reinforcement once again from the time we were small children. Oh my God, I'm a sinner. I'm, quote, a failure. Now, what I'd like to do here is to give you another perspective in terms of failure. Because failure is not a bad thing. It's just like when you have problems. You have a problem, it means you're going to have to make a change. When you make a change, the change can be then something that moves your life upward. It improves your life. Problems force change. Change brings about a betterment of your situation. So I once gave a lecture a few years ago that said problems are blessings in disguise, and they really are, because every problem forces us to do something, or otherwise we just wallow in self-pity and pain and never go beyond that. So let's take a look at the affirmation sheet for this morning. All right, the first affirmation says, bless and release. Now that's a statement that we've used in what we call New Thought metaphysics for many, many decades. Bless and release. Instead of holding on to something, instead of holding on to a grudge, instead of being mad and wanting to get even and hostile and all of these things that seem all too human to us, we want to bless and release, whether it's a person, a situation, or a condition. In this case, it's failure, or the concept of failure. So it reads, I bless and release any so-called, notice so-called failure. Because to me, from a mystical and a higher spiritual standpoint, failure does not exist, except in the credence that is given to it in the human mind. There is no such thing as failure. No such thing as the reality of failure. Now, of course, I know I can get some really heated arguments on this to say, well, my God, you haven't gone through the failure I have, but believe you me, if you'd experienced what I experienced, you'd know that that was failure. But it's so-called failure of the past from all levels of my mind and simply regarded as a learning experience. That's all. You failed at something, another learning experience. That's all. Flip it off. Another learning experience. That's all it was. All right, you've learned from the experience. The next question before you start to wallow in self-pity and self-doubt and negativity is, what has this taught me? And where do I go from here? Sure, there's going to be a knee-jerk reaction when you fail at something. I mean, that's only natural. It's only all too human as we're embedded in flesh and bone. But we don't hold on to it. And if it involves another person, let's have some spiritual maturity. And the spiritual maturity says, let go and release it. It was just a learning experience. That's all. But I'm not the experience, and that's the thing to understand, which is the next affirmation. I recognize that I am not any failure experience, for failure experiences are only temporary and not a part of my eternal self-oneness with God. Anything that is temporary is not lasting. Anything that is not lasting is not real. Think about it. Anything that's temporary, anything that doesn't last, isn't real. The expression that we've all grew up with, here today, gone tomorrow, it comes and it goes. We have to then, if we're going to get into real experience, we have to say, what is real experience? Real experience is only that which lasts. What is the only thing in this universe that lasts? The eternal. We could try to define it. We could try to explain it. We could stumble over our explanations, etc., etc. But that is the reality. The reality is that we are not the experience. So if you've ever failed at anything, you haven't failed at anything. You haven't. Because you're not the experience. This is temporary. We're just visitors here on Earth, on this physical Earth plane. We're visiting. And the older that you get, the more you realize that this is but a visit. Because you see the years slip by, and the older that you get, the quicker that they seem to be going by, and you start to stack up, what has this whole thing been about? And you look back over your life, and you realize that the only thing that has any real meaning is that which was lasting and is still with you today. So in your consciousness, what is the only thing that has been lasting? Hopefully, I would say the word G-O-D, God. I don't care what religion you come from. I don't care what your faith is. The one common denominator is that there is a supreme intelligence dash spirit dash mind dash creator, creative process. However you choose to define it, we are not here by coincidence. Nothing is by coincidence. Everything is governed by cause and effect. And so where you're sitting here today, any day where your body is traveling, you're traveling through this tremendous consciousness that has created you in its own mind and its own image. So you are not the experience. So you say to yourself, well, if I'm not a failure experience, likewise, then contrast, I'm going to ask this crazy question, am I a success experience? And what's a success experience, and how long does that last? There's a quotation in the Bhagavad Gita that I've quoted many, many times. It says, seek not pleasure, nor try to avoid pain. Because both come and go, and neither last that long. So you can spend enormous amounts of time preparing for your next pain episode, get all stocked up with all the drugs and all the medicinal herbs and whatever else you use, and be ready for it. And then when it comes, it's not going to last that long. But you may have taken months of preparation, read enormous amounts of books and volumes of literature and so forth to prepare yourself for something that comes and goes, because it's temporary. So when we experience success, it too is temporary. So you say, well, my God, I might as well just sit here like a lump on a log and do nothing. But you see, that's impossible. Because you are something, and what you are is the eternal. So if you throw out all of your personal concepts of failing and succeeding, then we get back to the mystical concept of I am. I am. I simply am. And the moment you get into that concept, excuse me, then the power that is inherently within you has the opportunity to completely take over. Until that time, you're struggling between going back and forth between are you being successful or are you failing? And it occupies your mind. It becomes an obsession. It becomes a human consciousness obsession. Am I a failure or am I a success? Which am I? And so you obsess over this, constantly obsessing over failure and success, in which neither are going to last that long. So why knock yourself out? Instead, You say to yourself, I am neither a success nor a failure. Now, I know all the books, all the motivational things are telling you, seek success, go to success, have your goals, remain focused. If you do this, you're not in the eternal state of consciousness within yourself, which is your real power source. You are equating failure and success with the human definition of failure and success, which, if you logically think about this, can fall far short with our limit, with our unlimited situation that we have as far as eternal consciousness versus limited intellectual consciousness. It falls far short. We are trying to ascertain or define our lives by whether we're successful or failures, which neither really exists. These are temporary experiences. It is not the real you. The real you is the eternal you, which is just watching this whole thing unfold. But in order to have creation, it gives contrasts of light and darkness, good and evil, failure and success. So we live in a make-believe world. In Eastern philosophy, they may call it Maya, they may call it illusion. We live in a greater illusion in order to have the illusion that we are having individual lives, and thus the cosmic drama continues. So again, I'm saying to you something here that it sort of goes against all of the self-help books, etc., etc. Don't consider yourself a failure, though the books will agree with that, but don't consider yourself a success either, because both come and go quickly. Whether it's not only your occupation, your career, it's your personal life, it's your health, it's everything. Everything has its definition of being successful or failing. Your health is good, I'm successful in the way I treat my body. Health goes sour, oh, I'm a failure. What did I do wrong? I shouldn't have had that extra French fry, whatever it was. Suddenly, you're back on a human level of consciousness, which is the great destroyer of truth, and you need that light inside of you to deal with what you believe to be your human and mortal life. Elimination. I regard all failure experiences to be part of an elimination process. That's all they are. You failed once, you failed twice, you got fired once, you got fired twice, you got fired a dozen times. It's part of an elimination process. You went into business once, you went into business twice, you went into business a dozen times, you failed every time. It's part of an elimination process. But it's not you. It isn't you that has failed. So the affirmation says, I regard all failure experiences to be part of an elimination process in the personal ego level of my mind. Why? To clear away all that is distracting me from what God's presence wishes me to do to experience success. But success in a success of your soul. Now, we can have success of the body, success of the mind, but in God's terrain, it is the success of the soul, i.e., the eternal part of you. Because we exist because we are supposed to be expressing some unique purpose of the divine. When the personal ego is interjected in there, we forget what the divine in us wishes to do through us. So the only real success, if there is any measure of it at all, is the will of God working through us. One of us is supposed to be an artist, the other one is supposed to be a composer, the other one is supposed to be an athlete, whatever it is that each of us is supposed to be doing. That's why Jesus said, I am about my Father's business. He didn't say I'm about Jesus' business. He didn't say I'm about the business of the Essenes or the Jewish cult or anything else. I am about my Father's business. Meaning my body, my mind is being used by Christ consciousness, that which is one with God within myself, And that is it. Now, I'm looking at you and some of you are saying, well, does that mean I have to become a saint? Does that mean I have to be holier than holy? No. But it does mean, what is your driving force behind your life? The driving force behind your life is to manifest whatever it is that God wishes to manifest through you, because that's why you were created. We become unique, individualized expressions of universal purpose, universal process working in and through us, each of us at our own level of unique expression. Already so, I accept that in the mind of God, at the center of consciousness within me, that all seeming so-called failures of the past no longer exist, and that only success for me exists in God's mind. But again, what is success in God's mind? Utilizing this body, this outer consciousness, for God's will. That's what it's all about. And remember, we can find fulfillment, we can find happiness. If you're intended to be an artist, and you're working as a clerk in a store, and you don't have any time to do your art, you're going to be unhappy. You go from the clerk to the assistant manager to the manager, then you become the district manager, then you become the regional manager, and finally you're the CEO, and you're unhappy as the blazes. All this time. Because you should have been painting pictures. And you never did. And that was the real reason, that was the real talent, the uniqueness, the individualization that God gave you to and created you for. So then the most important thing then becomes a matter of will. Your personal ego-driven will, or the will of a universal process creator, which will it be? I give up my personal will, which may have past failure experiences associated with it, to the will of God, which contains my success within it. But the success, again, is not measured by human success, by what somebody tells us we should or shouldn't do, or what strata or level we supposedly have achieved in life. I have met people that maybe are in from their mid-years on that became various things because their family got them into it. Father was an attorney, the son became an attorney. Father was a doctor, the daughter became a doctor. Not because they wanted to, but because the family said, hey, this is a good way to make a living, has security, etc., etc., you'll love it. I remember I went to high school with one young man, and years later we found ourselves in the Air National Guard together, and he had become an attorney, and he had been practicing law in Los Angeles probably then about maybe 7-8 years. And he said, you know, he says, I think I'm going to chuck this whole attorney thing. I said, why, Harold? He says, look, he says, I am not happy. He says, I like to get out in my garage and do creative things. He says, I get no joy from the practice of law. He says, some people do, but I don't. And I could see he meant it. And whatever got him into it, whether it was family or whatever else, it wasn't God's influence. It wasn't God's will. God's will had something else in mind for him. Success, again, is only that which is lasting. Only that which is lasting is that which affects our soul, not our human embodiment, which is ultra-temporary. Again, the older that we get, the more we realize our mortality as far as human life is concerned, and the more we should be focused on what is really real and what is meaningful. If we do this, we find a peace within ourselves. If we're still struggling with success in a human situation, we'll never find peace. We'll always be jumping around. Our system will never settle down. And without peace, there can be no happiness. Only the restlessness of the human mind, like a team of wild horses that has become out of control, and the person trying to lead them has lost the reins. And the mind becomes like this, scattered in every which direction. And there's no peace within us. I think if those of you, when you leave here today and go your respective ways, when you're in a quiet moment the next time, ask yourself, am I at peace? If you're at peace, the probability is that you're a happy person. In some way, in some measure, you've found the individualization of God through you. If you're not, if your mind is still restless, if your mind still feels I'm a failure at my personal life, I'm a failure at my occupation and career, I'm a failure with trying to take care of my health, then you're not at peace. And these very reasons keep you restless, they keep you off balance. And when you're off balance, you're not in balance, and then everything, your mind can't think clearly, and your body doesn't feel right. All of us have heard the expression so many times, only God knows. That's the truth. But the wonderful part about it is that God is our true ultimate self-identity, the Christ part of each and every one of us. So the God inside of you, which merges in individualization into the Christ within you, God knows. So it says, I accept that God knows my needs and creates success for me in accord with what is best for my eternal soul. I want you to look at that. What is best for my eternal soul? This is just a stopping off place. That's all that it is. We become so enmeshed with what is going on in society, so totally taken up by everything that is, and I know you're going to say, well, I have to, I've got to make a living, I've got to struggle, I've got to do this and I've got to do that. I mean, nobody hands you anything. Really? You've got the greatest power in the universe inside of you, knowing what you already have need of. The greatest power. There's no power on earth. All the kings, all the armies that have ever marched and proclaimed their power have no power by comparison to the real power. The real power that created the sun that's over your head today and created the earth that your feet rest upon. That's the only real power that ever has been, ever will be, and can ever be. That's the real power. You go with the real power or you go with the personal power. The personal power has its limitations. You go with wisdom or you go with foolishness. The reality and the choice is yours. Choose it under whatever label of religion you choose to. That makes no difference. Religions are basically man-made. With a little bit of inspiration that possibly leaks through from God within each human being. But make your personal peace with the presence of God within yourself. So it says, I accept that God knows what my needs are and creates success for me in accord, again, with what is best for my eternal soul. Not what's best for this stopping off place and this physical earth on this earth plane. Because we're travelers. We're travelers through the universe. We're travelers through that which appears to be time and space, but that which is really eternal reality. So we are part of eternal reality, seemingly having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment, for the purpose of eternal reality expressing through us in individualized ways and methods. If we allow this, then our soul is successful for this lifetime. If we don't allow this, if we try to put our personal will above this, then we will never find peace, and without finding peace, we'll never find happiness. And when we don't have peace, we can't think clearly. And when we can't think clearly, we don't make the right moves in life. And everything becomes a process of one destructive type of situation after another. Consciousness. My mind is open daily to be filled with creative ideas that bring me success. But where are those ideas coming from? If they're coming from the presence of God and deity within ourselves, then those ideas are creating the success that is according to God's will, not something that has been manufactured for us from our parents, a religion, our culture, politicians, or anyone. In other words, think for yourselves. Don't take my word for anything. Hell no. Don't take anybody's word for anything. Hell no. Go with what you are feeling as an intuitive process within yourself. Meditate daily to be in contact with the God in this body temple, this cathedral, on two legs that you're walking around with each and every day. Listen only to that still small voice, as the Bible states, that comes from within you. In the silence of your own thoughts, your own contemplations, it'll nudge you. It'll encourage you. It'll inspire you. It will give you that extra X plus factor that you need to turn so-called failure to so-called success. Remember, both success and failure in the human expression of it is a study in folly, an exercise. Because the only thing that is successful is that which is eternal. The only thing that is eternal is that which is the eternal part of ourselves. The only part that is eternal apart ourselves is the God part of ourselves. Consciousness. My mind is open daily to be filled with creative ideas that bring me success. Meditation. Through my daily practice of meditation, negative failure energy is sublimated into God's light energy to bring forth creative success ideas into my awareness. But those ideas are ideas that are coming from the God center inside of you, not coming from Madison Avenue, not coming from the political leaders, not coming from the baboons that try to educate us, not coming from the religious leaders. It's coming from within you. It all begins and ends with you. This life. Don't blame anybody for your misfortunes or your so-called failures. Neither really exist. The so-called failures don't exist except in the power that you've given them in your own mind. Real success begins with the success of the soul, not with the success of the human body or the intellect. Those are but tools to be used by the soul, with God motivating the soul. As I said in some lectures, real health begins in the health of your soul. It doesn't begin in the health of the mind or the health of the body. If the soul is healthy, the mind is healthy, and in turn, the body is healthy. It's a domino type of an effect, but it starts within the spiritual health within you. Now, those are some ideas and some affirmations that can be used to separate fact from fiction, reality from unreality. The main thing I want to leave you with here with this particular topic is this. So-called failure and so-called success are human concepts. Real success is only that which is lasting. That which is lasting, the only thing that is lasting, is the eternal, however you choose to define eternity. We are in eternity, born of eternity. Eternity is our real parent, thus our real God, existing within us as we exist within it. And that the only measure of real success is that which is lasting. And as I said maybe about a half hour ago, what is the only thing with most of you that has lasted in your consciousness over a period of years while other things have come and gone? The word God. The ultimate reality. That is the one common denominator. We are wired as it were, in our spiritual DNA. We can't help it. We're inseparable from that which created us. Hence, the Father and I are one, which applies to all of you. Let's sit back in our chairs, put both feet flat on the floor, ankles crossed, whichever is most comfortable for you. Let your eyes close for a few moments, and let's meditate on this reality that exists within us. I turn away from the outer world for a few moments to enter into the innermost world of my own mind, soul, and spirit. To leave the physical skies and earth behind me, that I may enter into an inner sky of my own mind, an endless sky of awareness that exists here within me. And so I turn my outer senses in upon myself. My mind turns in upon itself. All is an inward venture into consciousness. From the crown of my head to the soles of my feet, my outer sensing turns inward. Energy that I would use for sight and sound, speech, feeling, is turned inward. And I seek that which has created my senses. That which interprets life for me. That which is the ultimate reality within my own beingness. And so all levels of my mind are open to a feeling, a beingness, with that which is the eternal part of myself. And as I continue my inner quest to the heart and center of consciousness within myself, I blend away in consciousness, melt away into a clear peace and serenity within myself. Here within myself, I let go, moment by moment, breath by breath, till all time becomes as one eternal moment, and I rest in that eternal moment here within myself, and yet in oneness with all else beyond myself. My breathing becomes slow and deep as I reach into the deepest parts of my own mind and consciousness. Almighty mind, spirit, creative process, God of my being, I am open to perception of your presence in my consciousness.
am open to your inner light. I am open to an awareness of you. I am at peace in your presence. I feel a unity with you throughout my body. I am filled with your presence. Feet, my legs, my lower torso, my upper torso, my shoulders, my back, my abdomen, the upper frontal part of my body, throughout my arms, my hands, my neck, my ears, my eyes, throughout my head, throughout the entirety of my being. I am open to sensing, to feeling a higher presence beyond my personal sense of ego. As I sense and as I feel, let me realize that the power and the wisdom, the love and the healing, the harmony of all of nature and the creative presence of God exists here within me, and that I am a vehicle, a channel through which divine expression may occur. I recognize this as the real success of life, which is the success of my soul through this lifetime and beyond. I accept this now. I let this be so now. In a moment, I'll slowly begin to open my eyes once again and my senses to the outer world that surrounds me. But I will retain this presence that is within me, guiding me, leading me, directing me, living through me. So ever so slowly now, I'll begin to open my eyes, my senses. As I do, I'll stretch my arms and hands high over my head. And I do this as a symbolic gesture of always reaching for something higher in my life, knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars of the heavens of universal life, mind, and spirit, having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment. And I bring down my hands, resting in the security that this is so throughout my being, and so it is.